Now let me change to some views which I think complement this neoclassical view of land and growth and the view of land as and growth as a process of capital accumulation, and which add to that, and I think are quite useful, especially for understanding and considering a lot of common pool resource arrangements and collective property arrangements and their contribution. And this really is thinking that in the economics arenas, often thought of as new institutional economics, and that really that property rights and markets don't just come out of nowhere and are created by fiat, by governments or others, but really that they're constructed socially based on the supply and the demand for property rights themselves. And they're based on the kind of need to, in some cases, have more property rights protection. And in this view, rights are dynamics, are a dynamic social construction. They can evolve or respond to different market shifts or pressures. There's a real classic example given by Dimsetz in a paper from the 60s about the creation of property rights, in which he talks about a native tribe in Quebec in the 1600s, which had been up until the point when the demand by French colonists for more beaver, they had quite an open access regime for the hunting of beaver and pelts. But as the market value of those increased, and as the pressure from outsiders and the pressure to manage that resource became greater, the tribe responded by actually creating family rights to the different trapping areas. And that was a nice example of the way that property rights become socially constructed in the face of new market demand. So the demand for those rights occurred as the market pressure grew, and then these sort of family beaver hunting territories became defined, where before it had been essentially an open access regime. And so we see that this kind of situation ends up aligning the management incentives to have that renewable resource, in this case beavers, with the rights of different families involved, and can avoid the type of situation like a tragedy of the commons of over-exploitation or degradation of the resource. So I want to extend that because particularly in the past it had been this idea of the tragedy of commons, or this idea that common pool resources are missing property rights and therefore needed to be either fully privatized or needed to be, in other cases, fully nationalized, had held sway. And I think there's quite valuable and important thinking about these questions now on how communal and collective property rights are actually constructed and socially legitimated. And Nobel Prize winner Eleanor Ostrom has been one of the big figures in writing and documenting these kind of arrangements. And I think her key insight is that groups really can effectively manage all kinds of different common pool resource rights and develop, in fact, of quite a wide variety of institutional structures to do that management. So this construction of complex property rights management regimes. And I think now we're at a place in some of the global debates about common pool resources like global fisheries or even our atmosphere in which we need to think about how some of these constructions might work at a global level. And of course, this is occurring very much in the climate change debate.